Welcome to Masters of Innovation, a brand new concept in technology talk. On tonight's episode, we chat to a roundtable of sportsmen and sports commentators about the active role that technology has played both on and off the field. Masters of Innovation was hosted at the fabulous Rosa Room at the Palazzo Hotel Monte Cassino, perfectly located in the upmarket suburb of Huawei's Johannesburg, a mere 15 minutes from Sandton, South Africa's business hub. With the award-winning Monte Cassino precinct on its doorstep, guests can step out of the calm of the palatial hotel with its serene rooms, beautiful gardens, delightful dining options and spectacular swimming pool to indulge in entertainment in every possible variety. The Palazzo caters for small events, special occasions and intimate functions and offers a wide variety of food and beverage options by the hotel's top chefs to cater for every occasion. The Madeira restaurant at the Palazzo Hotel is headed up by the executive chef Gerard Fingerling. The restaurant offers a choice of both alfresco and opulent indoor dining. Guests can enjoy beautiful views across the tranquil gardens, and there are plenty of quiet corners for those wanting to share an intimate meal. Sunday buffet lunches are also available on the last Sunday of each month in Madeira. High tea is served daily between 2 and 5 p.m. Wine pairings evenings are hosted monthly in Rosa.
Welcome to the first, the premier episode of Masters of Innovation. We're here to have lunch, I'm told, to have a little bit of a controversial conversation, a real conversation. And we're really looking at how technology has been integrated into the sporting fraternity. We're having conversations that are based in South Africa, but also have a global outlook. All of you guys sitting around the table really have international experience. You are all sportsmen in one way or another, but also you've seen this integration and this evolution of technology in the sporting field. So that's what we're going to talk about. No rules apply to the conversation today, so everybody gets right in. But as you all know, I'm not alone. I am today being really lucky to have the show being co-hosted by the head of channel marketing for Huawei South Africa, yes. Miranda.
Well, I've been in marketing for a very long time, probably more than 10 years. I've worked in different brands. Technology has been my passion. I've been working in technology environment for the past actually 7 years. So I've worked in different brands. I love sports. I don't necessarily play sports, but I love it because I have a child who loves soccer, so I pay attention to soccer because he's passionate about it.
Nathan Paulse, I'm a professional football player for Ajax. For the past 17 years now, I've been a pro. I'm from Athlone, I'm Cape Town.
My name is Xola, Ntshinga. Been very fortunate to have been on pretty much every Springbok tour from 2007 until about 2 years ago. So I managed to pick up quite a lot of insight, and I hope it's useful in today's conversation.
Well, how do you get into rugby if you're not a professional? But it seems as if the strategy is go pro and then transition out.
So they say, if you can't play, coach, and if you can't coach, report.
My name's Mat Quinn, ex-Olympian, so I went to the 2000 Olympics, got injured training for 2004, and that's when I called it quits. Sort of ran 100 meters, PB of 10.08, so in those days it was pretty fast, today it's pretty average. Gold medalist from the 2001 World Champs where we won the 4x1 relay. I think it's in a box somewhere, so yeah, I mean, I've got my reasons for that, so yeah, we just kind of keep those things packed away.
My name's Gareth Flusk. I always think of myself as a cricketer. I have stopped playing, but I'm still a cricketer at heart. And then moved into commentating on various sports networks across South Africa, so live commentary and reporting as well, and moved into the news field. I couldn't be happy all my life, and now I'm in a corporate sphere, which is gives me a little bit of a different view of things. Yeah. I'm kind of on the other side of you know, the table. I have insight into sports and kind of bringing my sports knowledge into a corporate atmosphere in a boardroom as well, which I'm lucky enough to have, you know, be able to bring to the table.
So one of the most, my favorite things about the show is the drinking part, but I'm told that we have to eat at some point. So a chef is here for the day. Thank you so much for being here. What can we expect over lunch?
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Rosa. Today we're gonna start you with a calamari starter. It's calamari tubes, finely cut. It'll be served on a compressed cucumber, and then with a Pernod aioli, and then with some of the crisp calamari tentacles. So you'll really enjoy that, and some little sun-dried cherry tomatoes. Going on to the main course, we're gonna do a lamb neck. What we've done there, it's a deboned lamb neck. We've sous vide it for about 8 hours, so it is tender as can be, very flavorful. That'll be served with a carrot puree, with a butternut salsa, and then with a nice little lamb jus. And then going to the dessert, we're gonna spoil you with a lovely Irish brownie. Obviously, meaning there's a bit of whiskey in there. Then we're going to go with the coffee Irish ice cream. And then all the little extra little bits we put on with it. So hopefully you do enjoy, and yeah.
I thought that we shouldn't waste the opportunity to actually just get into the Olympic conversation. I mean, it is still super fresh. All I know is that 10 medals is, we're supposed to be happy about it. And then I saw they're talking about how the British team had landed at the airport in the UK with 67 medals. And should we be excited about 10?
So this is the best we've done ever since we've been reintroduced to the international sporting world. So I don't think we should sneeze at it. I mean, I saw an interview done with one of two medal recipients that Northern Ireland had managed to garner, you know, and they were celebrating this like you cannot believe that they managed to get two medals.
Yeah.
And it wasn't two gold medals, no, it was two medals. So so I think context is really important, and also Team Great Britain do have that added advantage of being Great Britain.
Beyond medals, I think what we've got to look at here is how many guys made finals, how many athletes actually did PBs. That's what's important. I think South Africa gets so focused on medals, and it goes back to the very first conversation. As soon as we launched it, we're going to the Olympics. This is the first team. We want to get 10 medals, and that's all the public care about.
Yeah.
But we don't hear the good stories behind it. I mean, one of the things that's been my gripe is Akane Simbine. He comes fifth in the 100-meter final,
yeah.
Yet everyone goes, that guy that ran in the 100, pity he didn't get a medal. No, his name is one, Akane Simbine.
Yeah.
Two, he's the fifth fastest guy in the world.
Wow.
And that's what we lose fact of. So for us to get 10 medals, I think it's brilliant. You know, it's a stepping stone. You know, we've got to set our sights even further. So come 2020, we've got to take it further.
Looking back in your history, because you're also an Olympian, you've got a medal in your past. Do you see the difference? How many medals do you remember you had in your time,
sure,
compared to now?
No, we've definitely moved forward. I mean, and the quality of the medals move forward. You know, when we can start saying, I mean, we missed a couple of golds. We know that. But I think the quality of the performance of the athletes is what's improving. And that's what we've got to take forward. So, yes, we've moved on since 2000, 2004. 2008, we got one medal.
Everybody who went to the Olympics to actually get a medal. Yeah. Where you think about it, like with Wade, I mean, he had an awesome season. You know, really burst onto the scene, and you know, he became flavor of the month, and it was like, wow, this kid can actually win a medal. You know, and obviously, you know, there was everything behind it.
So it was a realistic goal that you think that we set and we hit, and that's what we should be celebrating.
And you look, the athletes were competitive.
We've been saying for years now that we have the ability across all the codes. Where football hasn't quite lint is how to combine that ability with everything else, you know, and that's why you can have a Wade, you know, doing well, because he has the ability, but now they've obviously added tech into his training.
Yeah, you know? Let's talk a little bit about that. I mean, how did that come through? How has the Wade story been really fundamental to a tech story as well?
You hone in on what you need to improve. If you have a target, or if you know your area which you need to improve in,
yeah,
is your sprint technique, for example, then at least you can focus on that. And whereas without the tech, you'd be just
you're hoping for the best.
Yeah, hitting that mark, and unfortunately you have to compete against athletes that have that tech from
a while back.
Yeah.
When you were training in your time, how much technology did you have to guide you or to prep you in order for you to actually get to a point where you've won a medal?
Look, this is what I've always said. I mean, the guys these days are training smarter, better, and that's because of science and technology. They know exactly what they need to do. They've learned from mistakes. I mean, I used to do a training session where I'd do 10 200s, 10 300s. I can't eat some beanie and an arse and Wade. Most probably don't even go anywhere near that. So we were training blind, if you want to call it that way. We were just going out there and raw and going as hard as we can. That's what our coaches knew. But as we've gone since 2000 to where we are now, guys are so much smarter. They train smarter. I mean, the guy that got the bronze in the 100 meters, Degrassi, his coach went out and put that he never once trained him at maximum intensity. Now, in my day, that was just uncalled of. You know, we just never did that. We were just constantly training as hard as we can, putting our bodies out there. But they're smarter and they're better, and that's through science and through technology and understanding. You know, these guys, and social media is great because you get to see a lot. They take videos and they analyze, and the
but
guys'
Matt,
angles
are... But, is there a longevity issue here? So if you train smarter and with more precision and you're not training flat out, is there a correlation that we can conclude that you're likely to have a longer career? In that particular sporting code?
Absolutely. I mean, and I'm sure it's not just to track and field. I think if you look across swimming, it's probably the way they analyze their strokes and their techniques and the underwater cameras, all those sort of things give you so much insight into an athlete's performance these days, and that's where sport's gone. You know, sport is definitely improving, and it's not just about the equipment we wear, it's about how we're actually seeing, focusing, breaking down still cameras frame by frame. Okay, you're slightly off by one, call it a degree, you're out here, we've got to focus on this. You're reacting not as quick as, there's so much that we can still improve.
I was having the same conversation with Nathan.
Yes.
He was telling me about the vest that they have in soccer. I didn't even realize there's so much technology already in soccer.
Yes.
Tell me about it. How do you work on it?
Yeah,
the coach is no longer deciding based on the field only, he uses technology as well.
Yeah, so it's a GPS tracker. You know, that's in your vest. So they can track everything you do on the field, your intensity, your top speed, your peak. So for example, if you play in a game, it's expected of you the first half an hour, your level will be fairly high. Okay. After that, it depends on your fitness, you know. Yeah. So you can't cheat.
If you left the field with your vest on and somebody needed to find you, you know.
I think they would be able to find you, and also how fast you're going or how slow you're going, or if you're going at all, you know.
But I mean, there's similar things done in field hockey. So now hockey, they have rolling subs. You guys obviously don't. Now hockey, it's all about, they track you. It's all on a computer. They go, okay, well, player seven, he's at his intensity, pull him off because we need him to recover. He's going to recover in 3 minutes. So let's sub him and get him back. He's going to hit, once he goes through that threshold, he's no use to us on the field. Get him off, let him recover. Once he's recovered, they check, okay, cool, he's good to go.
Okay, let me just be unfair and be the devil's advocate. Xola, does this not erode the traditional sense of what we understand sports to be, like sports in its raw form, like human ability versus human ability? Because now it sounds like human ability plus tech versus human ability plus tech.
I think the time has moved, unfortunately. We are in an era where so much hinges on sporting results. It's a professional era.
Is it competition?
Competition.
It has become so intense.
It's become so intense.
Yeah.
Cricket is probably one of the sporting codes that is most notorious for the debate on where you push the boundaries with how far you take your sport. different calls from the umpire can be overruled by
technology.
Rugby is the same. We see what we call the TMO, the television match official, who has to rule, was that a try? Was it a knock-on? Was it foul play? Because so much hinges on that result. So I think a couple of years ago when we were playing sport for the enjoyability of it, fine, absolutely no problem. But now we're talking about a full-fledged industry. The sporting industry is absolutely huge. It sustains hundreds of thousands of people, jobs. It's an industry, so you don't want to leave room for mistakes.
And the technology behind it, as Nathan brought up, there are companies, global companies now, that go out to clubs, countries, national football associations, basically selling their technology to the team. So from a training session to a game, there are a whole series of statistics that, and you can plug into whichever statistics you want, whether it, and it works on fitness, it works on what your intensity is, it works on how much distance you've covered. So sometimes you'll see a strap coming at the bottom, and they'll do it sometimes with rugby, cricket, and companies go out there and they say, well, what we can do is we can film it and we will give you where certain players are going, what their movements are. And you must remember that that's not only for your use, because the opposition can have access to that very same information. But then you as a player have got to be so much better.
Yeah.
Because you've got to know then they're analyzing you, and if you are a marquee player.
Yeah, there's still a human element to statistics as well.
Yeah. Yeah. The mindset.
Because
the
you've got to become better than the analysis.
So stats can only give you figures. So you can have a GPS tracker, and all the professional sporting teams do now. If you watch the Springboks, they've got a, it looks like a bump in the back of their jersey. That's where they stick the GPS. And that tracks, as Nathan mentioned, the movement. Even G-forces, they can tell you how hard you were hit in a tackle because two G's were exerted on your body, for instance. That doesn't tell you how the player feels. It tells you how far he's run.
This is what I'm looking for, the mind.
But at the end of the day,
how does it make you feel knowing that you've got a GPS and you need to impress your coach because the stats are going to be read?
Yeah,
and if you don't qualify or if you don't meet the requirements,
it's part of the competitiveness.
It's a profession.
Like
it's exactly the same way you'll
analyze the marketing information in order to make an informed decision. Yes.
I mean, the coach is a boss now. He's got 11, 13, 23 players underneath him. And he goes, okay, well, who's performing? Who's not performing? Who am I going to sell at the end of the season? Who?
That's my issue. The money. My issue. Because if you go back to what Xola said, everything hinges on the result. So, because the result actually now is a commercial imperative.
There's a deal behind the person.
Exactly.
You're saying Bolts was probably on to go, if he had to run this weekend, I think Paris is on Saturday, Paris Gold Diamond League, he must probably get anything between 300 to 500,000 US dollars just to put his foot on the track. Not to win the race, just to appear.
Look, the money most certainly is the draw card. You as a commercial entity have got to make it work. I mean, as a player, most certainly, I mean, the more successful you are, you know, the more money there's going to be. And that's just the way, you know, sports works and life works in that way. So, you know, the two things balance out. And when you think about the technology of it all, there's so much that goes into the back end of it, into producing a better performance. Those players and those athletes are now much better rewarded in the same way. So it's almost as though the technology has built up this whole economy, and then
what runs economies is the movement of money and transactions underneath that economy.
That's right. And better performances, bigger crowds, the more money you'll make.
It's very powerful as well. I mean, we can use it as to connect people. People coming together, the fans, the passion in the country. I mean, we are a country that's very passionate about soccer or any sporting codes, actually. It brings us together. If you find people singing, you find us working together, whether it's rugby, whether it's soccer.
I think that's a fantastic point, because it actually leads us to think about whether technology has played a role in making the connection between the athlete, player, and the fan even closer. And that then feeds into this economy that you were talking about.
Yeah.
Other than your GPS vest, I mean, how else do you create that connection? And I'm teasing.
I think your fans want to see a player, you know, giving his all and you know, doing as best as he can, you know, because as a
as a fan, you obviously you're paying your money to see this athlete, you know. So I think, you know, us as players, we under a lot of pressure now to improve, you know.
Does it matter if you have a lot of fan base, for example, your yes. Twitter following is thousands compared to the other one?
Yes.
So does the coach usually use you as a tool since you have so many fans and bring you into the field? Maybe if your vest doesn't say you are fit 100%, but because you are the draw card to fill up the stadium, does that ever come into effect when you're being chosen to play?
I don't think it happens here yet in South Africa. But I think if we aspire to compete with the best in the world, because I think as a sportsman, you're always aspiring to compete with the best. Therefore, you have to unfortunately do what they do, you know.
But I do think that, and particularly with rugby in South Africa, I think it has gone too far. And there's been an incident down in KZN where, correct me on the schools, it was Hilton and was it Glenwood?
Yes, they had a big fight.
Now, what happened is they're poaching players at this amateur level already.
Right? School level.
School level.
Yes. Yeah.
So Glenwood, I don't know, these kids, and correct me if I'm wrong here, but basically you can go there at 10 o'clock and see that first team training.
Those kids, instead of being in class.
Yeah. They're not going to school for the sake of school, and schools are poaching players to win and basically for school pride. Yes. But it's the alumni that also drive that.
Yes.
I see school rugby games on TV, which I've got a problem with in itself because it's amateur. I don't see why kids should be on TV, yeah, because that's also giving them a false sense of superstardom at a very young age.
It actually starts at about age 13 because that's when the youth weeks start. And yes, I can tell you now of a professional franchise that hasn't got a major corporate sponsor in the same town as a school which is being sponsored and aided by.
Come on, I can see you.
I'm so not good. I am so going to keep my job after this. But one of the major car manufacturers sponsors the school, be it the professional side, can't sniff a contract. And that's because the value of school stars, sports stars, has just skyrocketed. It also still comes down to technology in the sense that now you can see the best schoolboys, and you don't need to be in front of your television. You know, the way we're ingesting media is so very different. So you've got, you know, somebody on the side of the field taking a little video, and these guys become mega stars on the net. I mean, some of the guys who are playing professionally now were discovered because they kicked a 60-meter goal kick when they were 17 years old.
So how do I then make this global phenomena actually work for me? Because I don't think you're going to be able to turn it back.
I think the one thing we're missing in this conversation is the business of sport.
Yeah.
Because let's take a look. Messi was signed at what age?
17?
No, 11. He was at 10.
Yeah, for Barcelona. It was 12. Okay, so let's look at the business side of it. So yeah, you got a scout. You put that video on. You suddenly bring him into Barcelona. Now you've got 50, 60 kids. How many of those are actually going to make Barcelona? But what Barcelona do is they groom them, they teach them the Barcelona style, they take them through. Yes, some of them might go into the first team thing, but the rest of them suddenly become a sell. They go, okay, hang on, Liverpool, you need a left back. We've got this kid, here we go. It becomes a business. So technology is
just... But that's a 10-year plan.
Yeah,
as opposed to a one-year plan, which happens here a lot. You know,
it's long-term investment.
Yeah, we don't think long-term. We think short term. We think I want to find the next star, but the kid hasn't finished school. He doesn't know how to handle fame. But the only thing we think of is, wow, he can play. You know, I throw him in that deep end. He can't swim. He handles it for a year or two. After that, he's gone. But it's fine because as long as the CEO, he has earned his buck.
It's funny you mentioned Messi. He is one of our ambassadors in our brand. I mean, I was reading a book about him at some point in my life. He's worked very hard to be where he is now. And if you look at our brand, we work hard. It's a passion point when it comes to sports. We connect people. If you look at how many people he's t- touched their lives. I mean, my little one understands Messi. I mean, he sees it in his soccer boots, he sees it in his t-shirts. So all that passion is growing and is bringing them together. When I watch him play on a Saturday afternoon, he's talking about Messi. He thinks he's going to be the next Messi, and he's only 6 years old. And you look at what Messi did with his life. Yeah. Again, yeah. He started when he was little, and up to now, big brands like ourselves and probably many other companies look up to him and say that story is such a good story to tell, and it matches the brand values, and you, Messi and the brand come together, and it becomes a...
So it's back to the industry and the new economies, and so drivers of that industry to some extent will be these marketing machines when you will be able to bring a Messi and a Huawei together. Yeah. But guys, there's a huge elephant. It's sitting in the middle of this table and we haven't addressed it, so I'm going to take the first bite. Let's talk Caster Semenya and what's happened
So this is pretty good.
And everybody starts digging in. I mean, I want us to talk about Caster and maybe remove ourselves as South Africans, and because I know as a South African we're probably emotionally vested in her success as well. But just from a sportsman's point of view, educate me and maybe myself, and educate Miranda as well. What on earth is the fracas all about?
The what? Look, I think there's two schools of thought here.
Yeah.
There's Usain Bolt's got natural talent, no one's going to come near him, that's how he was born, that's it. Michael Phelps, the same thing. And that, there's two schools of thought here. Caster's the same, built the same way she was born, the way she is. She's got natural talent, let's just accept it. The other side is that if we look at her from a genetics point of view, she has a testosterone level 3 times higher than anyone else.
Is then that any right? Female.
Any female. Female, sorry, any yeah. female. Some athletes have accepted Caster, some haven't. And it's those two schools of thought, you know, is she naturally like that or does she have an advantage?
She should, in my mind, compete against females, and that's where it is. I mean, you take an Oscar Pistorius, had a condition. There was certain technology that helped him compete, be very quick over the distances that he ran, but then competed. Nobody complained when they beat him in the able-bodied Olympics. People are born in a certain way and there are certain conditions that we're faced with. But the bigger issue for me is that I support her all the way, but my heart really goes out to her as a human being who's got to deal with being judged by people. I, as a South African, I fully back her as an athlete. As a human, I back her as an athlete. But the person, she's got to, you know, she's got to deal with all of this.
I just think there's a lot of other Caster Semenyas, you know.
A lot.
And if there's any positive to come out of the entire story is that we're having the conversation. It's happened before. Those suggestions have always been part and parcel of, in particular, track and field athletics. I mean, if you look at the old visuals of the athletes, even in 1940, whatever it was in Berlin, you know, there were visuals which would make you think, well, you know, you've got a very masculine female. She is very athletic and participates in whatever sporting code it may be.
Abnormality that this condition creates that makes the athlete significantly stronger or gives them the ability to outperform a normal, in inverted commas, woman. And if this does create an abnormality, do we then create another category for it?
Look at Caster's story, okay? So we go back, she got pinged and they said, please, you have to test her. So they tested her, they found, and everyone read about it. It was, you know, that itself is just disgusting. We should never have known about it. Should have been a private matter. But what happened since then she went on to medication. Medication brought her testosterone level down to a point where she didn't even qualify for the last Commonwealth Games.
Sure.
Her performance. So that's where I think people are coming. They're going, well, when we lower her testosterone
to
level,
average level
to approved, that's a terrible word because we don't even know what that is. She's not the same athlete. We take her off her meds and we all say she can break the world record. That's why I think CAST has been labeled with this.
I feel that the challenge that's been put on the table for South Africans and the world is that we've been wrong about our binary understanding of gender, for the longest time. There isn't just men and women. Clearly, it seems that it's a spectrum.
Exactly. The Canadians have officially, and I don't know how long it's been, it couldn't have been for the past, more than the past year or two, have the option on their identity documents.
So when do you choose?
To state whether you are male, female, or other. In the understanding that some people are transgendered.
Who is actually going to lead the conversation to clarify it? Because clearly, in every Olympic game, we're going to have this debate, is it a boy, is it a girl, is it a mixture, is it what? Who will lead? Who's going to step up and say, as a country, we believe our athletes, we are behind them because of 1, 2, 3. I know we had a campaign that says hands off Costa, but...
But it's no longer a national issue.
It's not a national issue. It's a United Nations issue.
Maybe the way we understand women is just too limited. In fact, women is all encompassing of... And I think it's a fantastic question because there is a huge gap and nobody's stepping up.
But the great thing about it, and to tie it back to technology, is that the debate is constantly online and we're privy to it. And I think you made a really good point when you said a lot of the decisions should not have been made public, but they were. But it has also just meant that there's almost no one who watched the Olympics who hasn't in some measure been influenced by this debate. So you know, that wouldn't come about if Kasta was not an athlete, if she wasn't at the Olympics, if she wasn't a sportswoman. So you know, again, technology is at the forefront of making sure that these conversations are happening and so much quicker as well.
I heard Wade is getting an Audi on return, part of the sponsorship.
Wow. He was their brand ambassador before he went.
Yeah, because the big question then was, where's Custer's Audi? Because that's what I started saying.
Okay, so just so I did the deal with Wade and Audi, so that's a great thing. So we'd signed that deal before you went to the Olympics, we pushed it through.
That's fantastic, because it goes back to, I mean, the whole brand behind the sportsman or the sportswoman that we've been talking about. And I particularly like the comment that you've made that there's been a huge shift from just on field to actually like off field as well. And this is why we know all the stories of all the footballers and what they get up to and who they're in bed with.
I find it refreshing when I can see a player. I actually don't want to know a lot more about them. I want to watch sport and I go, fine. I actually don't want to know. And I find it refreshing when I can't find out more about them. Because
that's because you're a sportsman and you see it.
I see the purity.
You see the competition.
But it's
a purist.
It's a different generation.
You're a purist. And the thing is, sport has got competition now. Yeah. They're up against pop stars and idols. And
I was going to say, it's no longer just playing soccer so well. It's about offside and your reputation and how many people are following you. And so us as brand people will run for that.
If we had a sports star that sat there and just did absolutely nothing, rent out, ran 999.
Yeah, came back with the gold.
Came back with the, or ran 9.8 and said nothing, didn't talk to anyone. He's not marketable. We're not interested in him. Twitter has given us, and social media and Facebook and that, has given us the opportunity to think we know a Wade, a Graham Smith, a Sachin Tendulkar, because as soon as they respond to us, now we're mates.
Yeah.
With all the technology and the way sport has been professionalized, and like high school and all the rest, what I think potentially is lacking is that there's one goal in mind, and it's money. And technology's driven that, and that's great, because your business, as your club, you've got to make money. Athletes, slightly different. You as your individual brand and your team and your support team's got to drive that. But where there's no investment, and technology could help, is that players are not grown as humans.
Ah.
They're grown as sports people, which is all fine and well. But when the system's had enough of you, the system doesn't need you anymore. Mm-hmm. And what happens is, when if you get injured, or if the system can't use you for whatever reason, too old, not good enough, whatever the case might be. And I use a lot of my peers who I played with, case in point. All they did, and some guys have moved on, but it was just cricket, 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 cricket.
We know so many stories of footballers
yes.
who got injured or something happened, and the next thing they were broke, they were down and out, and they don't have a cent to show, so they've gone from driving big fancy cars to absolutely having nothing.
Yeah.
So in the high years, in the heydays when the money is coming in and everything's going well, are they investing in themselves though?
You haven't been taught to think about investing and you know all the important things, you know. And it's a industry that's actually thrived on not empowering your players.
Sure. I'm going to put the blame on you guys.
Yes.
And literally say, where are the older guys, the
mentoring
exactly the incoming guys to
whoa,
be like
whoa, whoa,
no,
whoa, whoa.
No,
I almost
way.
Agreed with you for a moment.
No.
Did you just call us old?
No.
Okay,
I mean,
so let's go
mature guys.
Come on guys,
that's out of the table.
Isn't there a gap here? I mean, we know you guys know how the world works. You've seen them being flushed out of the system. You see these development
you've
academies
experienced
you know what the gaps are in the development academies. And yet we're still having this conversation in 2016.
Okay, I think going back to all this, we keep saying we've seen it over and over again. For a player to go through and not get a business manager compared to an agent is the first mistake. A business manager looks after your interests, not his. There's a massive gap in the market for it, for someone to go out there and physically look at, and they all think they're doing it, but there aren't many that are business managers looking at the funds and going, okay, cool, you don't need to drive that Ferrari. Let's invest it here. Let's do this. This is it. This is what I'm going to give you to live on. That's what you need. This is how we're going to invest your money.
I think we can wrap that point because I'm seeing a business idea already, so let's not talk about it.
There are players being forced every single day to watch him sign with a certain agent, and if he doesn't sign with the agent, then his next 3 or 4 years is not a set. So then
that fear of earning income, so now you're forced with what you've got.
Exactly. You haven't been empowered, and here you have an opportunity to earn whatever you've been given, but you're not sure exactly that you are worth.
The business of sport in this country, it's not run by sportsmen. It's run by a lot of other people who want to make money out of the sport, but not necessarily by sportsmen. It's run by administrators.
February this year, Wade had just run 998, being the first man in history, not just in South African history, to go run sub-10 in the 100, sub-20 in the 200, and sub-44 in the 400. Akani had just run sub-10 again. It was an amazing time for track and field. I personally went out to brands and I told them, and I even said to them, guys, understand, I come from a track and field background. I know Wade is going to break the world record. He will write Michael Johnson. And when I say Michael Johnson, they know who that name is. Mm-hmm. He's one of the great. Wade van Niekerk will write Michael Johnson out of the history books. A couple of oaks came back and we went back and forward, and I got, hey, but not interested. I even got one of those. A couple of the car brands didn't want to get involved. Audi jumped on board. Wade goes and does that. Suddenly they're all on Twitter. They're all saying, wow, we wish he was driving this car. We were doing this. One of the brands, only one of the guys came back to me and said, Matt, I'm sorry I missed the boat there. I should have listened.
Yeah.
And that's the problem in South Africa. The brand guys are so into the top three, we don't see beyond it.
Big transformation elephant.
That's a giant elephant. That's a giant.
I'm sorry. I'll go for it. I'll take a bite of it first. I'm brave. To be honest with you, I don't think it has its place there on top. Because if you want to compete for the best in the world, you have to send your best, irrespective whether they white, black, pink, or yellow. I don't care. Maybe a level or two down, there you can, especially in schools.
The average black kid, black or brown, whatever the kid, is not at Hilton, they're not at Michael House, they're not at St.
But
Charles.
They are at Greenwood and DHS if you take a look at the numbers now. And Greenwood and DHS have got really good competitive, probably even better than Hilton and Michael House.
Let me ask you, how easy is it for the child to be accepted in that school?
Yeah, but you're not going to get accepted into that school unless you've got a big check on your back.
Or if you live in the right part of town.
That's my question.
Yes, Xola, I mean, you'd know about this. Those schools, we spoke about it earlier though, because those schools invest so heavily in their rugby programs, what they do is they scout.
I still think there's value in that argument that you've raised, or even though I'm pushing against it. That you can't build from the top, you've got to build from the bottom up. Yeah. But when we're looking at the bottom, the pool that makes up the bottom, is that broad-based? Is like, see, you know, are we saying
but that exactly colors? Answers the question though, is if let's say there is an attrition rate of 20% of rugby players every year from the age of 13 to 18, every year you're going to lose 20% of your rugby players or 10% of your rugby players or 10% of your cricketers or footballers. Then your pool has got to be very big to start off with,
yeah.
Because you will lose a lot by the wayside.
Yeah.
You will lose a lot by the wayside. So the only way to gauge if there's going to be success and transformation at the very highest level is if there is critical mass at the base. Yeah. There's got to be numbers.
Yeah.
And we can't say kids are leaving sports only because of a lack of transformation. No, they leave for all sorts of reasons.
Opportunity only seems to exist in certain places if you are talented. So if you're a young black rising star, and cricketers, I'll use an example. So Hashim, where did Hashim go to school? He went to DHS. But like, that's because he was a good cricketer. And they saw he was a good cricketer.
They sponsored probably his fees, I don't know.
Well, yeah, he probably got a bursary. So he goes on and he plays South African and goes, rah, rah. It's like, but you double click on that and like, that's where the system is. Makaya went to Dale.
Mm.
So, because he was identified, went to the right school, right coaches.
And kept and groomed.
And goes up the mall. And there seems to be, look, there's a lot of different elements and that base is all about, look, it's upskilling coaches. It's the right facilities within the average school and look to get skills transfer into look very rural areas where there's bigger problems than developing sportsmen.
Yeah.
There are some very desperate places within South Africa nevertheless where there's no running water and there's no electricity.
My
producing sportsmen is not number one on the list.
Tennis court's not gonna fly.
Absolutely. Yeah. And there's bigger problems to solve, but like I'm saying that those centers of excellence still tend to be the schools that had it before 1992.
I mean, you talk about
still
Soweto
tend to
rugby
be there.
You know,
I'm not hearing of Soweto Rugby Club producing the string of players and guys.
No, because
to go
those
there.
Kids would have to attend Orlando High. Now, if you want to tell me you're going to go and build a rugby stadium at Orlando High, people will tell you you're absolutely barking up the wrong tree. It's not going to happen. Where are you going to get this money from? So it's actually. I don't see a change unless we step back and say, okay, guys, we're either integrating our schools, we demolishing
but
ones that don't have conditions.
We have a rugby field at Orlando High. For crying out loud, Orlando High is on Vilakazi Street.
This
is perhaps one of the most historical streets in this country.
We can, but can you imagine saying at the parents' meeting, okay, we need a rugby stadium. And the difference between Orlando High and Grey High School, which has produced more rugby players than a Grey College, more Springboks than any other school in the country, is that it's the alumni. They get involved and paid.
This is so frustrating. And they,
so it's the old boys club that will say, well, you guys need a new rugby field. Yes, let's build another one.
I'm literally sore from the point that he's just raised, because what it does, it nullifies a lot of the arguments that black people will make about investing back in their communities. So if you're saying it's the alumni, the old boys, the old Hilton boys, the old Michael House boys and so on, that are to a large extent investing back in their schools.
And additional school fees.
The political leaders, the people who sit with the big BEE deals in this country, a ton of them come from Orlando High. And it's 2016 and we're talking about Orlando High not having a rugby field. Okay,
so we won't get rugby players from
Olympia. Isn't that anymore?
But it leads them back to that quick fix, because if you're not prepared to put in the work over a long-term period, then unfortunately you're never going to get out of that hole which we're in. And I've always thought that the big issue in a football is that everybody on top, the powers that be, they all into this instant. Mm-hmm. You know, Ajax won't buy 3 or 4 players in. Ajax will go and find a boy that's 14 years of age, and they will groom him, you know, amongst about a group of 100 boys. But at least, you know, for the next 5 or 6 years, Ajax can send boys up into the top team.
We're moving towards a political change in the country. At a national level, we're gearing ourselves up for the elections. We don't know what South Africa is going to look like post those elections. I don't think we're prepared for the outcome of the local elections, to be quite honest. So in the time that we have, if we were to start putting in the building blocks, how do we build a sporting culture in South Africa?
We're in a situation where we have no choice but to fast track transformation. We do need a long-term solution, obviously. Obviously, we need a long-term fix. But we've waited this 20 years from readmission, or 23 years, whatever it is now, since readmission. And we're still talking about the same thing. From a rugby point of view, and I can speak at least freely about that, the change has always been, we want to see 15 black Springboks, or 11 black Springboks, or 8 black Springboks on the field. It's always been a numbers game. And that's how we've traditionally viewed transformation of, in particular, rugby and cricket as well. With rugby now, we've reached a critical point where we can't be looking at numbers. We've tried and failed, or tried and failed, or maybe not tried, but definitely still failed. And I think if we maybe change tack slightly, maybe we start by saying, okay, well, we can still talk numbers, but the numbers aren't necessarily how many black Springboks there are on the field, but how many black people there are in the stands supporting the Springboks. And you've got to get the kids to want to do that, because you know, if you want to be a professional, anything, any sporting code, you've got to put in the hours, the slog, when it's not nice to actually have to go and practice while all your friends are off smoking around the back of whatever it is.
Does that mean it goes back to the parents? Because who would encourage the kids now? Let me ask you, who puts those kids in those schools that are... it's the parents. Whose dream is it? Is it the parents' dream to get you to run in the track? Is it the child's dream?
I don't know. You need to ask the Williams sisters.
I think parents facilitate. Yeah. Parents need to facilitate. They've got to buy into your kid's dream. I mean, my folks used to take me to athletics training every single night when I wanted to go and what I wanted to do. If I needed a tennis racket, it was bought. You know, that they fully supported it. I was lucky enough to have parents like that.
We've covered a lot of topics. I think that, technology, I think, is incredibly powerful. I know that mobile technology has reached... You know, there's more mobile phones in this country than there are people, and people have 2 devices, and that's just, you know, on average, people have, you know, phone and a tablet, and that stretches quite far down into the LSMs as well. Yeah. You know, and so a lot of our in Africa, a lot of our first experience of technology and for kids will absolutely be on a phone or a tablet. I think we've got to be able to use technology to be able to shorten that gap of giving kids access to, and Kola spoke about that, creating that sporting culture. I think the beauty of South Africa is that despite adversity, we always seem to be able to produce the best. And I think it is, if anything, using a sporting analogy, you know, it's not about how you start, it's how you finish.
And go back to 2012. We suddenly got the four guys that won gold. Suddenly we were like, shock, horror, where did that come from? But what did they do? They took technology, they trained the guys, they worked them, they got a system. Suddenly we qualified 5 boats, 5 finals, 1 medal. That's moving forward. Just technology again. Go to what Vodacom did. Vodacom went out there in the next level generation, where they asked people to take images off their cell phone. Everyone's got a cell phone, mobile device, take it off, show them playing football. Winner of that competition actually gets a scholarship to Tux University, Tux Football, you know, something like that. But that's where we need to go. But think about it. 1 million people enter, there's only 2 scholarships. So as good as it is, it's still a competition.
It's still a competition. Nathan?
Yeah, to use your phrase, it's not how you start, it's how you finish. But I think the start in South Africa is too high up, you know. And again, I'm going to come back to schools. Schools with a tech, you know, that's how we can change. Because look, ability, I think we all agree we have. So therefore, we don't have to worry about ability, because we know there are a million kids out there that can play in any sport. But have they got that platform? No, and that's purely down to school sports. I mean, I'm who I am because I played football in a school. You know, I played every single day, but it was forced on me. Fikile Umbalula, if you are watching.
Well, business message.
School sports is your answer.
With regards to technology, very quickly as a broadcaster, I think from my perspective where I'm seeing it, and yes, there's a lot of stuff that happens in the back room. We spoke about the impact of technology in developing sports people, but I think that the biggest change has been in the way in which we consume sport and media. Because we all now consume on devices and phones, and we're mobile. You can be at the airport and watch the test match. You can be anywhere and watch the football. And that excites me. It's a game changer. It has been and will continue to be, I think, over the next, millennia, really. Just the way in which people are associated with sport. So, you know, technology and sport are going to be stuck hand in hand for who knows how many more years to come.
Going back to Huawei, when we talk development, which is why we partnered with IX, and another thing that I want to talk about is we've just recently launched an innovation center. Again, it's all about, as you said, transferring skills in the ICT industry, in the technology, in the sports. It's our passion point. Transferring skills, development. We are masters of innovation, so we invest a lot of money in such areas, whether it's the sporting with IX, it's the innovation center. Graduates will come from varsity and come and gain experience. We transfer skills and technology, we move forward. So again, it's all about transferring skills, transforming, teaching and supporting what the country loves, for example, the sport.
Well, on that note, thank you so much for making the time to join us on our first episode of Masters of Innovation. It's been absolutely fantastic. I think what I enjoyed the most was the little bite at the elephant. It's always fantastic when you've got controversy on the table, and I appreciate how you guys didn't shy away from the big issues and really getting in there. For myself and Miranda, it's been great having lunch with you. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much.
Awesome.